It's good to see everyone today. Welcome to the balmy Northwest, apparently here in Dallas, Texas. My name is Mark Yarbrough, and I serve as the Academic Dean here at Dallas Seminary. And what a wonderful week. And we are excited and looking forward to what the Lord will do and speak to our hearts. And it is my privilege to introduce our plenary session speaker this morning and for the week. Matt Mikalatos is an author, husband, and father who is passionate about Jesus, telling stories, and learning how to share God's love with the people around us. He has been on staff with Crew for 16 years and lives in the Portland, Oregon area with his wife and three daughters. His wife, Krista, is with us here today. Krista, would you please wave your hand? Yes. Krista earned her master's degree in cultural anthropology and has been a seminary and college professor and is also on staff with Crew. Matt works both locally in Portland and nationally, and much of his time is spent helping followers of Jesus become more effective evangelists and disciple makers in their local context. Matt has published 6 books, which take a variety of forms and genres, from kids' fantasy books, The Sword of 6 Worlds, to memoirs, his most recent, Sky Lantern, to theology, The First Time We Saw Him and Into the Fray, and an inexplicable comedy theology novel thing. How about that? My Imaginary Jesus and Night of the Living Dead Christian. We'll just let that one sit out there for a little bit. The one thing Matt's books have in common, other than the author, is a desire to entertain readers while bypassing their defenses and taking them closer to Jesus. Matt has been writing consistently since college, though he didn't start getting paid until he started writing for the late, great Wittenberg Door, a Christian satire magazine. He loves fiction more than just about any other thing in writing and can often be seen with his nose in a book or reading a comic. He strongly believes there is room for more voices in the Christian arena, and that people should write about what they truly love, not try to fit into a predetermined mold. He's glad to talk about writing until you get a little bored and slowly inch away, making some excuse about needing to go to class. Well, we welcome Matt to Dallas Theological Seminary, and may he challenge us to be better representatives of Christ into people to the world today. Would you join me in welcoming Matt today?
Thank you.
God bless you.
Thank you. As a child, Kapi'olani wondered what a banana tasted like. Because to eat a banana, as many other foods, turtle and a variety of things, they were kapu to her, taboo, forbidden. Because she was a girl. It wasn't allowed. And even though she was a princess, essentially, she couldn't break kapu. No one could, because the penalty was death. But Kapi'olani had this insatiable hunger for bananas, even though she had never tried them. And one day she was with one of her handmaidens, and they were down by the beach near the temple, which was made out of lava rock, essentially, piled up. And she saw this servant boy, Mao. And Mao, she played often with Mao, but he was a servant. And she and her handmaiden decided there was no one around. And she called Mao over to her and said, "Mao, go to the altar. Bring us a banana." And Mao said, "No, it's kapu." She said, "Mao, you're a servant. I'm a princess. Bring me a banana." "No." But finally, Mao agreed, because you can't say no to the princess. This also is kapu. So what could he do? So he brings her the banana, and she and her handmaiden, laughing, run out into the ocean, turn their back to the shore, and eat the sweet delight of a banana for the first time. And they drop the peel into the water and turn laughing to see the priest with his hand on Mao's shoulder waiting for them on the shore. And her heart sank. And when she came, the priest was furious. And he went and brought her aunt, who she lived with. And her aunt stood there, and he said, "As you know, to break kapu means death." And her aunt said, "You cannot kill. You cannot kill Kapi'olani. She's a princess. And there are many other possible punishments, but you cannot kill. That cannot happen. Was it not Mao who stole the banana?" And the priest took his hand upon Mao's shoulder, and they turned and they walked into the darkness of the temple. And the last thing Kapi'olani saw was Mao's face, terrified, as he turned back to see her before entering the temple, and she never saw him again. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, there are so many dark days in our history as a people. And this was just one small one, one tiny tragedy for those who didn't know you. I pray today as we turn to your word that you would speak to us in powerful ways and that your Holy Spirit would show us those words infused with your spirit, that we might be the people to bring truth, that we might be the people to bring love, that we might bring transformation as your representatives to the people of the world. In your name, amen. Now, for the early church, there had been dark days too. And in fact, in a very famous day that we talk about, it had been 50 days for them. A very full 50 days, a month and 3 weeks, give or take. That's how long it had been since they had seen their teacher, Jesus, beaten. And sometimes I like to reimagine these things as if they had happened today, to bring that space between us and 2,000 years ago, to make it a little more real to us. But it had been 50 days since they had seen their teacher beaten with nightsticks by the authorities, slung up on a tree, hung and murdered by a mob. It all started on a Thursday night when the sheriff's men arrested Jesus during a prayer meeting. And by Friday at 9, he was on the tree. People were hurling filth and insults at him, and by 3 in the afternoon, he was dead. And they lowered his body onto a sheet, put him into the back of Joseph's SUV, and drove him off and put him in a crypt. And then 47 days ago, everything changed when some women came running into another prayer meeting to say they had seen him, the teacher, alive, which no one believed. Until some of the men ran to check on their story. And the stories continue. The people had seen him, had seen angels, had heard from one another that Jesus had returned not as a ghost, but as flesh and blood. And then for 40 days, the still living Jesus walked among them, appearing among them in a variety of ways. And over, he taught them the same thing in those 40 days. Every time he spoke to them, his message was the same. For 40 days, share your story. Tell other people. Tell the whole world, every nation, all your neighbors. Let them know the good news. And then 7 days ago, he had left them, narrowly missing a jumbo jet, and he had told them to wait for the gift that I'll send to you. And that's what they did. They went to a place, it's more of a joke than anything, that they called the attic, right? The upper room. And it was actually in a wealthy woman's house. It was a large room, and about as many people as are in this room right now were in that room. And they were praying. And they were praising God and singing and waiting. Just waiting, telling stories. Sometimes Peter got up to speak, which felt strange. Pete, with the big beard and smelling of fish. Pete, the headstrong, blustering oaf. Now he seemed to be thinking about them, watching over them, and people wondered what it was Jesus had said to him because something seemed different. But they were all waiting, everyone on edge, everyone's nerves frayed, thin and brittle as tinder, and then came day 50. Now imagine a forest. How many of you have been in, in the Pacific Northwest where we're from, we have like a rainforest. How many of you have been in a forest where just everything is green? Like it seems like even the light coming in through the leaves. Yeah, everything is green. Lush, animals moving in the underbrush. And somehow, sometimes what happens is an old log will catch fire, right? Maybe it's the sunlight, or maybe someone's thrown a match, but there's a sound of air being sucked into it, like a whoosh. And when that happens, the whole woods hits something called the flashover point. It's this moment when flame moves as fast and powerful as wind, and it lights the bushes and the trees and everything on fire simultaneously, and the air moves hot and fast, and you could be caught in the middle of it. Scalding hot air, flames, fuel, and it's spreading. That's what it was like in that room. One moment, everyone was just there, and then next, boom, an explosion. There was a sound like wind that filled not only the room they were in, but the whole house, and something like fire came and rested over their heads. And all of them began to tell the story of the teacher in other languages. This holy breath, the Holy Spirit, he spoke through them. He gave them the words. And what was that like? I don't know. What would they say if we could interview them today? What did it feel like? It hasn't happened to me, not like that. But who knows? Like being blown along by the wind? Like catching on fire, but not burning up? Like taking a deep breath of superheated air and breathing out beauty and wonder. And they spread from that house and out into the streets like any fire would. And people in the crowd were there who had come from all over the world. And they could pick out their own language from this strange group of babblers, right? Whatever that language was, Chinese, Persian, Farsi, French, Greek, whatever, everyone started to say, what is going on? Is this like one of those reality shows where they're going to trick us afterwards because everyone's speaking? Is it performance art? Is this some military action? Is this a prank? And then the heckler started to say, probably college students, because you know how college students always say this, they're drunk, right? That college students say that to everything. What's wrong with that guy? He's drunk. What's wrong with those guys? Drunk. Why is that guy driving like that? Drunk. That's just, if someone's acting weird, that's clearly the answer. So the hecklers start to shout, drunk, they're drunk. Those guys are drunk. That's how they learned all those languages. The alcohol does strange things. So Pete stood up to talk to the crowd, and if the first miracle that day was the wind and the fire of the Holy Spirit, and if the second miracle was that people started to speak in other languages, certainly the third miracle must be that Peter stood up and gave this speech. Because they all knew Pete. He was this hot-headed, pig-headed, block-headed guy, and that's not even counting what his brother would say about him. That's just what everybody knew. This is the man who asked Jesus to heal his mother-in-law, and yet when Jesus said to him, let's catch some fish, he was like, I mean, I guess I owe you over my mother-in-law thing, but that's not going to work. I'm the fisherman here. This is the guy who would physically attack someone trying to arrest the teacher and then shout that he didn't know Jesus. Later that night, at the first sign that he might be arrested, this was someone who blustered and cursed and shouted at people. He literally said things that made no sense. Scripture says this. He said it because he didn't know what he was talking about during the transfiguration. That's what it says about him. He made promises he couldn't keep. He followed the teacher with his slavish devotion, and then he tried to correct him. But that doesn't describe the man who stood up in front of this crowd, the rabble. No, Pete looked at the hecklers, and he smiled, and he said, drunk! They're not drunk. It's only 9 a.m. As if to say, you know, even us poor people, we don't get the whiskey in the jar quite this early. Takes a little time. And then he started this story. He said, this is in Acts 2. God told us long ago, he said, remember what he told Joel 600 years ago? He said that in the last days, he would pour his spirit on human beings, on all people. He told us that our sons and our daughters would teach God's truth, that our young men would have visions and our old men would dream true dreams. Men and women, he said. He gestured to the men and women behind him who were sharing their stories and the languages of every person in the crowd. God would pour out his own spirit on men and women, and they would teach truth. And there would be wonders in heaven, fire and blood and smoke and signs on the earth, and the sun would go black and the moon would turn red because it was time for the glorious coming of God. And he said, his voice cracking, everyone who calls on the name of God will be saved. 50 days ago, this man had denied knowing Jesus. And that day, scripture says, 3,000 people saved themselves. That's what it says. They saved themselves. 3,000 people. When's the last time you were in a crowd of 3,000 people? New Year's Eve, maybe, at Times Square? Or a sporting event? Or maybe an American mall during the holidays? Like, when have you been around 3,000 people? And that's what we saw, 3,000 people, all of them begging to come to God and find forgiveness. That's what happened on day 50. On day 50, the Holy Spirit burst onto the scene. He was the flame and the oxygen, and they were the fuel. And the fire burned and spread and consumed every heart it touched. Every story about the apostles in the book of Acts is actually a story of them being carried away by the Holy Spirit, of him speaking through them. He does mighty acts, and they are vehicles for those actions. He speaks through Peter. He speaks through Stephen and Philip and Paul and the others in Acts. The community of faith, the apostles, the deacons, the missionaries, the players big and small in the church, the Holy Spirit guides them throughout Acts. He leads them, speaks to them, teaches them, empowers them. The book of Acts is first and foremost a book about the righteous actions, not of the people, but of the Holy Spirit. And what's the first thing the Holy Spirit does when he shows up on the scene? What's this great strategic plan Jesus had for reaching the whole world? How does he start? He shows up and he tells a story. He bursts into the room where Jesus' followers are gathered. He pours himself into the men and women in that room, and he begins to tell the story of Jesus through their lips, forming the words with their mouths in strange words and strange languages. Men and women, young and old, preach to those who don't know Jesus. Here it is, the first church meeting, the first service. And the order of worship is everyone preaches. At the same time, which I'm not suggesting, you know, we need to do that, because I kind of like having the stage. But, and Peter finally stands. You know, the words start to mix together a little bit. Peter finally stands before the throng, and he shares the Spirit's message, which is right. There was a man from Nazareth, Jesus, who came from God and proved his divinity through miracles, wonders, and signs. He was handed over to the authorities, who instead of doing what the authorities should and protecting the innocent, protecting the powerless, the wicked leaders conspired to murder him. And then God raised him from the dead, and now Jesus has been made both Lord and Christ, the Messiah, the Holy One, the one sent to save us, the Savior of the world. It's interesting because it's not really a theological discourse. It's a set of events that he's laying out. It isn't a lengthy description of God and who he is and his character. That's revealed through those actions, but that's not where he starts. It's not like Paul's letters, which carefully walk through the theological concerns in these careful terms to make sure we understand what he's saying. It's a story. And like many stories, it starts with this simple invitation for the people to listen. And it's significant, I think, that the good news is first and foremost a story. And that's because, yeah, everyone here is going to have a theological degree eventually, hopefully. Right? That's the plan. And that's good. And some of us struggle with theology. Some of us find it easy. Some of us are like saying, why did God invent Greek? It seems hard. But all of us are working through to get these degrees. But the fact is, among the people that we minister to in the future, very few of them will have seminary degrees. And if they see all of following Jesus is about learning really difficult theological terms or learning another language or all of these things, what they need to understand, what we need to help them understand, is that every follower of Jesus has a story. All of us, every single one of us, regardless of our theological training, we all have a story about him. It starts with the first time we see him. And it moves from there through highs and lows, through darkness and light, storm and clear weather, till it comes to this precise moment, the moment where we're sitting around a campfire somewhere, explaining to someone the story of how we met and who he is. And the people around us listen with wonder or disbelief. So Jesus gave his followers this directive: teach everyone on earth, what I taught you. But wait until the Holy Spirit comes and brings you power. And when he arrives, the Holy Spirit comes with that plan, that story that turns the whole world upside down. So I understand why eventually someone took this letter that Luke wrote and they said, let's call it the book of the Acts of the Apostles. I get it. But I wonder if a better name wouldn't have been just simply the Holy Spirit tells a story. And that story that the Holy Spirit tells is the good news. And the Holy Spirit has done this so many times, and it's not all ancient history. It's not 2,000 years ago only. Consider Hawaii. How many of you have been to Hawaii? It's like one of the places God has blessed this earth with. In 1808, there was a Hawaiian boy. His name, we call him now, oh, forgive me, sir, for butchering your name. In 1808, it was a young man. His name, we call him Henry in English, but his Hawaiian name was Opukaha'ia. And in 1808, he was 15 years old. There had been recent wars, and his parents and his brother were all killed. And one day, he saw a ship out in the bay with square sails. It was one of the Westerners, one of the foreigners, the Haoles. And so he swam out to the ship. There was nothing left for him in Hawaii, he felt. And he was taken aboard. He barely spoke any English, and the ship was bound for Boston. So he went, 15 years old, to Boston. And when he got there, he was sort of adopted and began to study with tutoring English from a little Christian college called Yale. It was new then and tiny. So while he was there, he learned English and then went on to Greek and then to Hebrew. And he, translated all of Genesis into Hawaiian, which is pretty amazing because, he basically invented a written language for Hawaiian. In 1818, 10 years later, at the age of 25, so this had all happened in 10 years, you guys can get your degrees, hang in there. He learned English, Greek, and Hebrew in 10 years and started translating things, so you can do it. In 1818, he fell sick with typhus, and his classmates all came to see him. It was pretty clear he wasn't going to survive, Henry. He was going to die. And before he died, he grabbed hold of his friends and made them promise to take the good news of the story of Jesus to his people, the people of Hawaii, which they at that time called, the Americans called it the Sandwich Islands, which I'm not sure why, because they're so tasty. I'm not sure. So at the age of 25, he died after wringing a promise from his classmates, please, please go to my people. And so there were seven couples that decided to do that. all of them, almost all of them in their 20s. There was one couple, there was an older couple that went with them. They were both 32. So on October 23rd, 1819, just a year after Henry died, they boarded a ship to Hawaii. And get this, to go, they knew this was going to be a lifelong thing, so every single one of them, every single American one of them, gave up their citizenship so they could go become a part of the Hawaiian culture. And so off they went. One of them was a woman who we'll mention again in a little while. Her name was Mrs. Laura Fish Judd, and we still have her her journals. Amazing woman, Laura Fish Judd. Okay, meanwhile, in Hawaii, this is amazing, there was a guy named Kamehameha, which means the lonely one. And when he was born, just born, one of the kahunas, the holy men, said, "This man is destined to bring much blood among the chiefs of other tribes," because the Hawaiian Islands were ruled all by different tribes, essentially different rulers. But Kamehameha I went around all the islands and he united them all under his rule. And he made sure that everyone worshiped the gods, everyone followed the kapu, everyone made sure to do all the right things and to make the sacrifices and to stay in line. But when he died, Kamehameha II, his son, said, "We're not going to do that anymore." And so that he took his mother and his sister and they sat down for a meal, which men and women could not eat together. It was kapu. They sat down for a meal, and when they were done, they stood up and went to the holy temple and put their hands on it. And then he said, "Kapu is broken. Those gods are no more." And he burnt the idols. Why? Because he'd found Jesus. No. No, no one had come to tell them that. Because he said, "These are not true." And then other people within his kingdom said, "This is not right." And as you can imagine, there was a small war over this as the priests said, "You can't say the gods aren't true." And he said, "I can. Everyone will do this. Bury or burn your idols or I'll kill you." And that's what he did. He killed them if they refused to deconvert from their traditional religion, a religion that had been worshipped in the islands for 600 years. And there was a holy man there, a priest, a kahuna, one of the highest kahunas, and actually descended from one of the most famous religious people, one of the most famous kahunas, and his name was Hewahewa. And he said this, "I knew the wooden images of deities." We have all this written down, by the way, because this happened in the 1800s. "I knew the wooden images of deities carved by our own hands could not supply our wants, but I worshiped them because it was a custom of our fathers. My thought has always been there's only one great God dwelling in the heavens." And then he prophesied and he said, "Lono, the God of peace, has left the islands." And he was standing near the royal palace when he said it. "Lono, the God of peace, has left the islands. And when he returns, he will come to this black rock in the bay by the palace, and he will come in a black box speaking a language the Hawaiian people do not understand." And so on March 30th, 1820, 196 years ago this month, the missionaries arrived and their boat landed at that rock. And they stepped off with a little black book that no one could understand because they couldn't read English. And all of the kahunas, not just the one important kahuna, all the kahunas said, "Ah, his prophecy has come true at last." And the first people to convert to Christianity were the royal family. So the missionaries arrived in Hawaii in 1820, the Hawaiian people having already dismantled their temples and having rejected their religious beliefs. And by 1840, nearly 20,000 Hawaiians had chosen to follow Jesus. Wow. One of those people was a young woman named Kapi'olani. When the missionaries first found her, she was lying naked on the beach, sunning herself with her two husbands. As Mrs. Judd wrote, they were like seals. just laying there, enjoying themselves in the sun. And she was well known as a woman of enormous appetite, drunk much of the time, and she ate really whatever she wanted, including bananas. 3 years after coming to Jesus, she looked around at her people and said, "Why are so many of the people still worshiping the ancient gods? The Kamehameha II has said we're no longer to worship, that Jesus is clearly better than them, especially the goddess Pele, who was the goddess of fire and volcanoes. Why are they worshiping Pele?" And the people would say, "We're afraid. We're afraid of Pele." And only a few years before, the volcano had erupted and many people had died. So they knew Pele would become angry and kill people if she needed to. And so the priests and the priestesses, who weren't supposed to still be active, would still go up the volcano and they would throw these sacred berries that no one else could eat into the volcano to feed Pele, to keep her safe, to keep her satiated, so she wouldn't reach out in anger toward the people of Hawaii. And Kapi'olani was not someone who sat idly by when she saw things. And she said to her husband, she only had one now, she said to her husband, "I am going to go to Mount Kilauea and show the people that the power of Jehovah is greater than the power of Pele." And he said, "Oh, wife, don't do that." And she said, "I do what I want." Pretty much word for word. And then he said, "At least take a canoe so you'll get there quickly." She said, "I'm not going to take a canoe. I'm going to walk through the island and tell everyone on my way that I'm going to talk to Pele and tell her that Jehovah is greater than her." And he said, "Oh, wife, please don't do this." And she said, "I do what I want." And so she did. She walked barefoot through the lava fields. She took her time. She took a giant retinue with her. And every town she stopped in, people would gather to go with to see what would happen. And when she came to the foot of the mountain, a priestess came down from the volcano, shouting at her, speaking in tongues, and then saying to her in Hawaiian, "If you set foot on this volcano, that's Kapu, Pele will kill you. If you walk up to the top, Kapu, Pele will kill you. If you do anything on this mountain, Pele will kill you." And Kapi'olani said, "No, she won't. She won't." And she began to sing to her hymns she had learned in the last several years, 3 years since she'd been a believer. She began to read to her the scriptures that had been translated into Hawaiian. And the priestess began to shake and would no longer speak. And they said, "The spirit is in her." Kapi'olani said, "I don't care." And she kept reading to her. And at last, they had her sit, and she sat with Kapi'olani and her people, and she ate. The next morning, they stayed the night at the foot of the volcano. The next morning, Kapi'olani took her people, and she walked to the top of the volcano. She said, "Jehovah is greater than Pele." And she took the sacred berries and she ate them, which is what she did. She took rocks, threw them to Pele, and then she sang songs. She read scripture and she said, "The power of Pele is broken over my people." It's an amazing story, amazing woman. Years later, she was sitting on the porch of Mrs. Laura Fish Judd's house. And they were talking, and she told her a story how many years ago, when she was a child, she had convinced a young boy to bring her a banana. And she said, "I don't know what happened to him. I never saw him again, but I don't know what happened." And the priest from that day was still living. And so she called him, and he came because she was still royalty, even though he was no longer a priest. And he came and stood on that porch next to the Bostonian missionary woman and the Hawaiian princess when she said to him, "What happened to Mao?" And he said to her, "Princess, those were dark days. We wanted to hold on to our power. So we did the things we did. And she said, "What happened to Mao?" And he said to her, "I strangled him and placed him on the altar." And Kapi'olani began to weep. And she turned to Mrs. Laura Fish Judd, 24 when she had come to the island. And she said to her, "Oh, why? Why didn't you Christians come sooner and teach us better things?" Talking about missions matters now. Today, there were people who would say to us, not only come and tell us about Jesus, but why has it taken you so long? Why haven't you come already? Men like Henry Opukahaia who would beg us, "Go to my people." Women like Kapi'olani who will boldly show their people the power of God for salvation, if only she first could hear the good news. In Hawaiian, if you've been there, people say aloha. And the meaning of aloha is the presence of breath or the breath of life. And it has other meanings that come from that, the idea of love, incredible love. When they talk about the highest love, they'll say aloha. But when someone says aloha to someone else, what you're saying is we're mingling our breath, our spirits. We breathe together. It's a beautiful thing, this idea. In this breath, this wind, this spirit, there is life. Aloha. I share your breath. It's not that much different for us than all these things we've described, the story in Acts 2. The conditions are right this week. We're here remembering what Jesus has said and done, just like they were in that attic. We're here singing and praying and huddled together, just like they were in that upper room. Who's to say that right here, God might not choose to start a fire? Because the light shines brightest in the darkest places. So if we're to be messengers of that light, let's go into the dark. Let's go to them. I want to close with a prayer. It's a prayer written by the last queen of Hawaii. Her name was Liliuokalani. And the story of Hawaii takes a tragic turn in religious sense a little later. And we'll talk about that later this week. But Liliuokalani was the last queen of Hawaii, the last ruler of all of Hawaii. And she was a believer, a follower of Jesus, and she wrote many, many prayers. Is there a brother or sister here who is from Hawaii who speaks Hawaiian? Anyone? Okay. I've got this beautiful Hawaiian prayer, but I really don't want to butcher the words. It's disrespectful, I feel like. So let me read you in English it's a song and a prayer. So I'll read the lyrics to you as our benediction. This is her prayer. And as I read, the band's going to come back up. But here is what Queen Liliuokalani, the last queen of Hawaii, wrote. She said this, let's pray. "Your loving mercy is as high as heaven, and your truth so perfect. I live in sorrow, imprisoned, but you are my light. Your glory is my support. Behold us not with malevolence, the sins of humanity, but forgive and cleanse. And so, O Lord, protect us beneath your wings, and let peace be our portion now and forevermore. Amen."